Hello everybody. Today's session will focus on what is leadership, on trying to understand how leadership differs for different people and how difficult it is to actually grasp the essence of what leadership is all about. When we look at our movies, the depiction of a hero is always in terms of a whole lot of positive attributes. So what exactly do we mean when we talk about leadership? As people who are interested in studying human behavior, psychologists found leadership to be a very fascinating topic. Lot of research has happened on leadership. From the days that studying human behavior started in an organized manner, on a scientific basis, leadership has always captured the attention of psychologists. Looking more at the concept of leadership, they understood that things are not so simple. Fundamental question being, can we have a leader when there is no follower? Which means leadership as a construct, leader as a concept, cannot be understood in isolation. It has to be understood and it has to be looked at by taking in these multiple perspectives. Is it by birth? Is it because of his personal characteristics? Is it the situation? Is it the people he has around him? Or is it the people she has around him? What makes a person stand out as a leader? But then, as research progressed, they found wide variation. Somebody who is a people's person seems to be a very effective leader. There is another person who is a contrast, who is very authoritarian. He or she is also a very effective leader. So where is the parallel? There was a high degree of lack of consensus. So leadership as an individual attribute received moderate support, but there was always room for debate. There was always room for a lot of discussion, always a possibility that leadership could be something more than what one person has within him. When you are trying to look at leaders, study individuals as leaders, what exactly would you study? Is it their intelligence levels? Is it their personality? Personality characteristics? Is it their motivation? These are some of the things that psychologists then focused on. One, looking at their personality characteristics, leadership as being part of a personality. When we say personality, we are looking at all those enduring characteristics which together make a person. So, is there something distinct about the personality of leaders? So, several attributes were studied as part of study of leadership as being part of an individual's personality. And what did they find? They found that leaders were generally high on several factors, like most of the leaders were extroverts. Most of the leaders were high on extroversion. They were also very high on conscientiousness. That is, their dedication towards doing what they are supposed to do, the work on hand. Most of the leaders in the work context had a high degree of work ethic. The leaders were also found to be high on empathy. What is empathy? Empathy is the ability to relate to people. Empathy is the ability to understand what another person is feeling, what another person is going through, and being able to relate to it and being able to respond accordingly. So, governing my responses according to how another person, how the opposite person is feeling, is what empathy is all about. and leaders were mostly found to be high on empathy. There is also another aspect to the personality that most leaders exhibited. This is humility. The leaders were mostly found to be humble about their achievements, about their performance. So, research focused on multiple factors when they were trying to understand a leader's personality. Fine, so far so good. But then what? Can I predict so and so is going to be an effective leader based on these results? That is where there was a catch. That is where the psychologists found that this doesn't seem to be adequate to understand the entire construct of leadership. This is when the focus then shifted to other aspects like intelligence, like the level of motivation in leaders. Again, all the studies seem to have some kind of a moderate level of success. In fact, there was one line of thought where psychologists said that leadership is nothing but what is attributed to other individuals. So, when we are talking about leadership, research at that point moved from looking at people and trying to look for characteristics within people to looking at what they do. The focus is not on what are they. The focus then shifted to what is it that they seem to be doing? What are those actions? What are those behaviors which seem to identify a leader? So, at this point, researchers try to identify a person playing a particular role. When we are looking at leaders, when we are talking about leaders, maybe the person is not what needs to be focused on, but the role is what needs to be focused on. What is a role? A role is all those actions, all those expected behavior patterns when a person is behaving in a particular manner, when a person is in a particular seat. So, as a manager, how do I behave? As a father, how do I behave? As a student, how do I behave? So, each of this is a role that an individual plays. And when people started looking at this, what they identified was that there are three kinds of roles that leaders seem to play. One, interpersonal roles. Two, informational roles. And three, decisional roles. Let us look at each of these in detail. Informational roles. What do we mean by information? Informational role. A role where the person gives information, takes information, collates information, or is identified as the person who is responsible for information. So, when a leader is playing informational role, he is seen as a figurehead. Let's take an example. The principal of your college. In that particular seat, today Mr. X might sit, tomorrow Miss Y may sit. But as a principal, irrespective of whether it is X or Y, they have a certain informational role to play. The governance of the college, ensuring that there is law and order within the campus, ensuring that exams are held in a free and fair manner, ensuring that classes take place, ensuring that all the interest groups, be it students, be it teachers, be it support staff, all the interest groups' interests are taken care of. That is part of the principal's job. So, as a leader, as a head of an institution, he is playing the role of an initiator. He also serves as a liaison. When there are two groups in conflict, it is the principal's job to ensure that the conflict is addressed in an effective manner. What does this group feel? What does that group feel? What is this group's viewpoint? What is that group's viewpoint? What are their grievances? Sharing this information, because of the barrier in communication between the groups, the principal becomes the wire media. The principal becomes the negotiator. So there is a liaison role being played by the principal. The other role that every leader plays is an interpersonal role. Sharing things, keeping in touch with people, getting to know what each person wants, what each group wants, and ensuring that a balance is maintained. This is part of the interpersonal role that every leader plays. What makes a person distinct from the rest? Who becomes a leader? When there is a group, there could be one designated authority. Let's say there's a group of friends. There is one person who seems to be more in touch with all than the rest. He or she becomes the anchor of the group. Very often what happens, once this person moves out, the entire group disintegrates. So in such cases, what is happening? This person is the hub, the interpersonal negotiator for the entire group. So this person becomes a de facto leader within the group, a group of friends, where usually you do not find this kind of a leader subordinate situation. So leader does not necessarily mean someone who is given a title. Leader does not mean always someone who is given a position. Leader could also mean someone who is most effective in maintaining interpersonal relationships and ensuring group cohesion. A very important role, a third role that leaders play, is that of a decision maker, a decisional role. When choices are to be made, whenever there is more than one person, inevitably it leads to multiple choices, a difference of opinion, differing viewpoints. And when you are looking at a group, the larger the group, the more the complexity. The larger the group, the more the issues. So a leader has a decisional role to play. A leader takes decisions. Not only decisions in terms of a reactive manner, that is when there is a problem, but also decisions in terms of what next, taking the group forward. If you take the head of the state, a prime minister or a president, depending on whatever kind of government a particular country has, they don't just look at governance, they also look at how do we take our relationships forward. The leader is also a resource allocator. There is always a shortage of resources and always a greater need than what is really there. Within the group, everybody wants to have power. Everybody wants their word to be carried out. Small, subtle differences, as something as simple as I want to watch this movie, you want to watch that movie. Finally, which movie do we go to? We all want to go together. So when your friend's choice is supported by the rest of the group, you may feel let down. Now, the leader in a group, in the role of a resource allocator, would say probably, we will go for this movie because 1, 2, 3. Out of the group of 5, 3 have already seen it. Probably the 2 of us can go for the other movie some other time, some other day. And whenever there is some kind of a disturbance, the leader also plays the role of a disturbance handler. He is the one who handles disturbances. He is the one who influences the group. He is the one with the authority. He is the one who can resolve. Are we looking at leadership as a static concept in the sense, once a leader, always a leader? So-and-so is a leader, the others are not leaders. No. What research has found is leadership as a concept means a person can be a leader in different situations at different times. And another person can be a follower. Today I'm a leader, in a different context I'm a follower. Within my class, I'm a leader. At home, I'm a follower. So when we are looking at this kind of an equation, what are we looking at? We are also bringing in factors like followers and situation. So this is exactly how leadership research also evolved. Psychologists then focused on trying to see how leaders behave with followers. That is where the focus shifted to leadership styles. People generally have a particular way of doing things. Let's say you have exams, you're not prepared. Different people react to that in different ways. Let's say the exam is tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Half the day is already gone. Now, she may decide that out of these chapters, the last 3 years' exam papers seem to be focusing on, out of the 10 chapters, 4 chapters. These 4 chapters definitely figure in the question paper. So I'm going to look at only this and I'm going to forget the rest. I'm not going to spend time on that. Then there's a second person who cannot rest unless and until all the chapters are at least browsed through. You would at least like to know briefly what is there, because you believe that if you give a quick glance, you can fill in the rest based on whatever you've picked up in class, whatever you remember. There is a third person who totally gives up. Half a day is not enough for me. I know I cannot do a good job. Anyway, it's enough if I score something like 40 to 60. A fourth person may feel so stressed out that I need a break and then watch TV for some time and then pick up books and then fall asleep. And the next morning, they wake up. Anyway, the day is done. Anyway, I have to go and write my exams. I'll go take a shot. If not, there's always another chance. So same situation, different people have different styles of reacting to it. And what is interesting is the example that I've said, that I've quoted just now, we take exams repeatedly, all students take exams every year, year after year, the same pattern repeats. Whenever there is a similar situation, the same pattern repeats. Once the students graduate and go to a work environment, again, a similar pattern repeats. This is exactly what we mean when we say style. Style of functioning, style of behaving. So, the next round of leadership studies focused on trying to understand leadership styles. One very simple way of trying to classify different ways in which leaders behave was looking at how they behave with the followers. How far do they let the followers take control? In one case is the authoritarian leadership. Who is an authoritarian leader? An authoritarian leader is one who wants to have the control in his hands. I tell, you listen. I dictate, you follow. Most of the dictatorships, most of the controlling type of people generally have an authoritarian style of leadership. Highly authoritarian people, in fact, want to stay in control of the situation, no matter what, no matter where. There are also situations where an authoritarian style actually works better. Take the case of defense forces. Take a war. A soldier is in fact trained to obey orders. Why? Because in such situations, an authoritarian style ensures that the entire troop is performing as strategized, as decided. Any dissent, any questions could have a very, very costly effect. It's a question of life and death. There is also the other extreme. The leader lets the followers give in to their own style of doing things. As long as whatever is the set goal, as long as that is reached, I don't really bother about how you're doing it, why you're doing it, who was all involved, is it according to what I want, is it not. So this style of leadership is what is called the laissez-faire leadership. It comes from the French word, it's a French word whose meaning is let it go, leave it. Where would such style be effective? Generally, in situations where you require a lot of creativity, where you require a lot of individuality, in such situations, a laissez-faire style is more effective. There is a third style, that is the democratic style. A democratic style of leadership is a style where all the voices are heard and the majority opinion governs the final choice. Similarly, in a democratic style, the leader takes the opinion of all the subordinates, takes the opinion of all the followers, and the ultimate choice is always what is acceptable to most of the people, what is best for the group and what is acceptable for most of the people. So this is a democratic style of leadership, and this is very effective in most of the situations where there are multiple choices, gray areas, and a requirement for people to feel that they have been part of the process. So in such cases, a democratic style becomes far more effective than an authoritarian style or a laissez-faire style. But what happens if there's a mismatch? Let's say I'm dealing with a group of people who don't know how a particular job is to be done. Or I'm dealing with a classroom full of students who don't know anything about psychology. Now, if I tell them, if I have a laissez-faire style of leadership, and if I leave everything to them, people who are interested and who want to put in effort would probably read. But the rest would take the easy way out. And eventually what will happen? The results will suffer. And my effectiveness as a leader of the subject would go down. So the style of leadership has to match with the situation. Two other researchers brought in their findings to come up with a different way of looking at leadership. This is what is very popularly known as the managerial grid. Blake and Mouton, these are two people who together came up with the managerial grid concept in trying to explain different styles of leadership. So what is this managerial grid? What is a grid? A grid is usually a set of squares. Okay. So managerial grid refers to a 9x9 matrix. 9 on x-axis, 9 on y-axis. 9 vertical, 9 horizontal. Think of 9 boxes put side by side in a row, and 9 boxes piled one on top of the other in a column. So in entirety, what you have is a grid of 9x9. So what is this grid that Blake and Morton were talking about. They said there are two fundamental things we need to keep in mind when you're talking about leadership styles. What does a leader want? One, the goal has to be achieved, the task has to be done, whatever the group is together for, it has to deliver that. So one is a concern for production, that is concern for the job on hand, concern for the task. The other is a concern for people. If I focus only on the job and I ride roughshod over people, the group will disintegrate. So the other dimension was a concern for people. So based on these two dimensions, Blake and Morton created their managerial grid and identified five distinct styles. Someone who is very low on their concern for production and concern for people. You have these kind of leaders as well. Usually, you find these kind of leaders in formally designated seats of authority. These are people who have become leaders because the structure has put them in the place of a leader. They are not bothered about production. They are not bothered about people. They are more bothered, interested in saving their position as a leader. Now, this style was what is called the impoverished style. At the other extreme is someone who wants the work to be done, who is totally focused on production, that is concerned for the production, highest, that is level 9, and also is concerned about each and every single group member. That is a team style. Somewhere in between a 5x5 kind of a position, that is what is called the middle of the road. I have concern for production. I also have concern for people, but sometimes my focus is more on production, sometimes my focus is more on people. That is a middle of the road style. The other two styles are the country club style, where what is a country club? Where the focus is on relaxation, getting to know people, spending more time together, networking. So a total focus on people, not really bothered about what is it that you're doing. So that is a country club style. And finally, the produce or perish style, which matches with the authoritarian style. That is, I want this to be done no matter what. I don't care what you personally feel. This is the produce or perish style that Blake and Morton had designated in the managerial grid. Blake and Morton's managerial grid was highly effective, highly appreciated, because they identified five styles and people started looking at which style is effective where. Instead of just three kinds, authoritarian, democratic, and laissez-faire, which focused only on leader-follower behavior, leader-follower relationship, Blake and Morton's grid looked both at the work or the goal and also the people who constitute the follower group. So this was an improvement in leadership research. So leadership theory, in fact, is a very rich body with multiple perspectives, and the research is still ongoing.